Consider the accompanying radiograph. What do you notice? Well, it doesn't take a chief attending in radiology to identify the large metal rods found on either side of the vertebral column. And if you have any sort of background in orthopedic anatomy, you might identify these as corrective surgery for scoliosis. But what else can we deduce from the image? For example, are there any clues to tell us the age of the patient in the radiograph? A trained radiologist may look for growth plates that might suggest a young adolescent or markers of bone degeneration that might indicate an elderly individual. But there's a more subtle clue which suggests we're looking at a relatively young patient here. Take a look at the radio-opaque object just below the patient's right hip. Any ideas what this might be? At first, you might be thinking some sort of medical implant. I mean, what else could it be, right? Well, it's not a medical device at all. It's a toy car. And it's not implanted in the body. It was left in the child's pant pocket during the x-ray. The fact that radiographs superimpose multiple images into a single two-dimensional image has led to a number of images falsely suggesting the insertion of foreign objects in body cavities. In the case on the screen, we see a radiograph implying that a Buzz Lightyear doll has been inserted in a place where no Buzz Lightyear doll should ever be needing to explore. Of course, with an image like this, the comedic possibilities are numerous. For example,
to infinity and beyond!
Or, my personal favorite,
you've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me.
The field of medical imaging is critical in reaching an accurate diagnosis and requires careful interpretation of three-dimensional anatomy represented in two-dimensional space. We will make constant referral to medical imaging throughout the course, and it's the physician's main tool for interpreting anatomy and gross pathology in a clinical setting. This journey begins with this brief overview into the field of radiology. Good day and welcome to this introductory session on medical imaging. The foundations of medical imaging are built upon a strong understanding of gross anatomy and the anatomy of disease states. It requires the practitioner to take two-dimensional images taken from radiographs, CTs, MRIs, and ultrasound, and interpret the findings in three-dimensional space, using their understanding of the anatomical orientation of the different organs of the body. It takes a lot of time and practice to properly read these medical images, and your understanding of radiological anatomy will grow throughout the course, as your knowledge of gross anatomy also grows. The purpose of today's lecture is to give you an overview into the field, to provide you with an understanding of the origins of some of the most common types of medical imaging techniques, and the theory behind their functioning. Now, this only provides an introduction to various medical imaging techniques, but by the end of the session, you should be able to identify many of the advantages and limitations related to each type of imaging technique and begin to recognize which techniques are most suitable for diagnosing a given medical condition. Medical imaging is the field of medicine related to generating representative images of the internal structures of the body. For the most part, we think of radiology as being a critical part of diagnostic medicine, but it's important to recognize that imaging is also important in interventional techniques to assess the placement of implants and procedure outcome. Before diving into the various techniques, let's take a minute to address the term medical imaging itself. This is actually a relatively new term in the grand scheme of things. Traditionally, the field has been referred to as radiology. This is because for years, the only imaging technique available involved passing beams of high-energy radiation through the body, which generated an image on radiographic film. Over the past several decades, however, additional techniques have been developed which don't use any form of radiation whatsoever. Collectively describing all of these techniques as subdisciplines within the field of radiology is therefore inaccurate. It's also misleading to the patients, who assume that all these techniques must involve some sort of radiation exposure and worry about side effects that don't exist for certain techniques. There is therefore a gradual shift towards the term medical imaging, although it is relatively slow to be adopted, as even residency programs still use radiology as the official term. If we're going to start a discussion about radiology, it makes sense to start from the beginning. This takes us back to 1895, to when a German physicist named Wilhelm Röntgen was conducting experiments using cathode ray tubes within a light-proof cardboard box. Now, as fate would have it, a sheet coated with a barium compound from an unrelated experiment was lying close to Röntgen's apparatus, and he noticed that the screen glowed whenever an electrical discharge was passed through the cathode tube within the box. This led to a series of experiments in which Röntgen concluded that an as-of-yet unidentified form of electromagnetic radiation existed that could pass through solid barriers in which light could not. At first, Röntgen was unsure of what to call this new form of radiation. So, as any good mathematician would do, he labeled them with an X, the letter commonly used to represent unknown variables. In the years that passed, there was an attempt to label them Röntgen rays in his honor, but the term X-ray, which Röntgen originally used, had stuck and is still in use today. While we're on the topic, the term X-ray is also used colloquially for the medical images created using this technology. For example, it's not uncommon to hear someone say, "Hey, take a look at this X-ray of my ankle." Formally, however, these are properly referred to as radiographs. X-rays are really only supposed to refer to the beams of energy that generate the images. Another fortunate accident occurred when Röntgen tested the beam's ability to penetrate different substances by holding them in front of the phosphorescent barium screen and observed that the beams could penetrate flesh, but not really bone. Now, as any good husband would do, he brought his wife into the lab and said, "Hey, honey, check this out," and had her place her own hand in front of the screen while he took a picture. The result, shown here, complete with Anna's wedding ring, became the first ever radiographic image. Now, apparently his wife was so freaked out over the experience, she immediately screamed, "I have seen my own death." Remember, prior to this point, the only time you would ever see bones was after a person died. Röntgen soon published his work, and it wasn't too long before the medical community recognized the clinical applications of this work in diagnosing bone tissue disease and fracture. The principles behind radiology are simple enough as far as the physics go. When an electrical current is passed through a cathode ray tube, electrons are emitted from the cathode and strike the anode at the opposite end of the tube. This excites the electrons within the anode that jump to a higher quantum energy orbit. When these electrons fall back to their resting state, they release energy in the form of electromagnetic radiation of a specific wavelength, which is what we refer to as X-rays. These emitted waves can penetrate objects with varying degrees of success. When an object is placed between a cathode tube and a photosensitive screen, the rays will pass through the radiolucent material and strike the screen, creating a phosphorescent glow. Beams that strike a radio-opaque material will be deflected at varying angles, and these points of the screen remain dark. The varying degrees of phosphorescence that appear along the screen are what created the visible images, which represent the X-ray diffraction patterns of the objects in front of the screen. Although the phosphorescence fades when the X-ray is turned off, still images and motion pictures can be taken of the screen for preservation's sake. On the left side of the screen, we see a video demonstrating various joint movements, providing a unique perspective on how the bones articulate and move deep to the flesh. In the video on the right, we see the peristalsic movement of food and liquid through the upper digestive tract. Now, these videos are relatively old, and with pretty good reason. The old expression, "they don't make them like that anymore," really holds true in this situation. Fluoroscopic videos exposed the participant to a large volume of radiation that was not initially anticipated, and such high amounts of exposure would be considered unethical by today's standards. Now, as we'll see, the technology has improved to minimize radiation exposure, but fluoroscopic studies are now limited to necessary clinical cases exclusively. Over time, the technology progressed. Rather than taking a picture of a fluorescent screen, radiographic film was adopted to cut out the middleman. The concept is similar to that for photographic film. The film contains a coating of silver halide compound. When the film is exposed to X-ray radiation, the silver precipitates out of the compound and stains the film black after film development. Note the differences between the fluoroscopic image, in which regions struck by the beam appear lighter in the image due to phosphorescence. With plain film radiographs, the opposite is true. Regions of the film appear darker relative to the unexposed regions. For this reason, fluoroscopic images are sometimes referred to as positive images, while radiographic images are referred to as negative images. Traditional radiographs made use of film mounted in light-proof containers referred to as radiographic cassettes. Each cassette consisted of a metal encasement with the film sandwiched between phosphorescent screens. The fluorescent emissions from these screens with exposure to radiation leads to further exposure of the surrounding film. This serves to amplify the effect of the X-ray beam, allowing for lower levels of radiation to be used. The back of the cassette contains a lead plate, which absorbs the transmitted beam after it has passed through the upper levels of the cassette. If a radiographic image were taken of a lead shape, the diffraction pattern would be more or less black or white, with either 100% of transmission or refraction of the beam. It's a different situation for biological specimens, in which only a portion of the beam is typically refracted. Portions of the beam do reach the film, but the exposure is not as great as would be expected if the beam was unimpeded. This results in varying degrees of diffraction, known as shades of gray, based on the specific properties of the given tissues the beam has to pass through. Not sure that there's 50 of them, but there's a few. To simplify things, we generally use four basic densities in relation to diagnostic radiology. Air represents the portion of the image void of biological tissue and appears black. It may not seem to be that important, but it does provide a reference shade to compare the tissues to, as it ideally should be the same intensity of black for any given radiographic image. Fatty tissue does not do that much in the way of diffracting X-ray beams, and therefore produces a darker shade of gray in diffraction patterns. Tissues with high water content do a bit of a better job of diffracting these beams and so generate a lighter shade of gray. Because of its mineral content, bone does the best job of diffracting X-ray beams and appears very light gray to white on the image. When present, metal from surgical prostheses and dental fillings also fit into this category and appear completely white in the image. Because of its strong contrast, bone tissue is ideally assessed in plain film radiographs, and any workup of suspected fractures or bone diseases should involve some sort of radiographic series. It can be used to identify fracture lines, osteoarthritis, osteoporosis, osteosarcoma. Basically, if it has an osteo in the name, you're going to want to order a radiograph. It can also help you appreciate when things are truly messed up beyond belief. A lot of technical skill is involved in taking a proper radiograph. A number of standardized views have been developed, and the patient should be positioned to reproduce a chosen view as closely as possible. Many of these standardized views are only selected for looking at one or two specific structures, but others are routinely ordered, providing a broad view of large regions of the body, which can help in visualizing a variety of conditions. For visualizing the thorax, a coronal plane or head-on view is most commonly used. This requires the ordering of either a PA radiograph, in which the beam passes from posterior to anterior, or back to front, through the patient, or an AP view, in which the beam passes from anterior to posterior, or front to back. This brings us to our first big concept to understand in radiology. For any given image, X-ray beams are passing through the entire specimen to reach the screen. So the image produced is a representation of a three-dimensional object compressed into two-dimensional space, similar to the foreground and background of a photographic image. To interpret the radiographic image, we utilize the same skills that we do in interpreting the 3D perspective within these images. The added difficulty with radiographs is that structures lying within the same path of a given portion of the beam will all contribute to the diffraction pattern for that portion of the beam, and as a result, these structures will be superimposed upon one another within the radiographic image. It's pretty easy to distinguish superimposed objects in a photograph, where the foreground object occludes the background object. It requires skill and anatomical knowledge to interpret the three-dimensional orientation of superimposed structures in radiographic images and distinguish anterior from posterior. So if the anterior and posterior structures become superimposed in a given radiograph, is there any difference between a PA and a P view of the thorax, and does it matter which is ordered? Well, the short answer is yes, it does. On the left is a postero-anterior view of the thorax, and on the right, an antero-posterior view. Note the hazy appearance of the heart on the right, which is a characteristic of an AP view. The reason is related to the distance the beam has to travel after diffraction from the object to the radiographic screen. Consider the shadow produced by the hand on a sheet of white paper. As the hand moves further away from the paper, the beam has a further distance to travel. This makes the hand look enlarged and blurry compared to the shadow produced when the hand is closer to the paper. The same effect occurs when an X-ray beam passes through the heart. As a result, the heart appears enlarged and blurry in an AP view, which can mask other structures of interest. For this reason, a posterior-anterior approach is preferred whenever possible, with the chest pressed flat to the screen, the hands on the hips, and the elbows pushed out to the side, which helps in protracting the scapula, providing a less obstructive view of the thoracic cavity. AP views are typically reserved for cases of bedridden patients that can't be properly positioned for a PA radiograph. In these cases, it should be clearly noted on the film that this is, in fact, an AP view, so that the enlarged heart image is not mistaken for cardiomegaly. One final note, regardless of whether an AP or PA view is used, the image is always oriented as if the physician was viewing the film from anteriorly, with the patient's left side positioned towards the right of the screen. I mean, think about it. When you have this radiographic image, which is more or less a sheet of film with different degrees of transparency, depending on how much X-ray radiation hit it, the white only appears when a bright light is shown from the other side. So, flipping the film around, just a mirror image of the film. It therefore became standard practice to flip a PA view around, as it represents the way in which a patient would typically be viewed. As a result, the term AP view is generally used regardless of the approach taken. It's important to understand, however, that even when the clinicians discuss an AP radiograph, it's almost always been taken using a PA approach. In some instances, a lateral chest radiograph can also be taken, with the patient raising their arms over their head to avoid obstruction of the view. This provides an alternative view of certain anatomical structures, such as vertebral bodies, that's not possible in the lateral view. It's also performed in combination with AP views to provide additional information that can be drawn from a single view. For example, consider the following AP radiographic image showing a foreign object along with the body. In this case, we are looking at the blade of a kitchen knife with the bone metal density we discussed a few minutes ago. The handle is made of a radiolucent material, such as plastic or wood, which is why it doesn't appear in this image. So, what are we looking at? Is this a stabbing victim or someone carrying a knife in their coat pocket, similar to the child carrying the toy car at the start of the session? And if it's a stabbing, is a knife entering the body from the front or the back? It's impossible to say with a single AP image, but when the AP view is combined with a lateral chest X-ray, further conclusions can be made. The two images combined tell us we have a patient that has been stabbed on the posterior right side of the body. And just in case you were curious to know more about this particular case, the lines seen here represent the top of the dome-shaped diaphragm that separates the thorax from the abdomen. In this case, the knife enters the thorax, continues into the abdomen, and, being on the right side, likely leads to a lacerated liver. An additional technique that is often used in conjunction with radiography is use of contrast media. This involves the uptake of a non-toxic medium that contains a radio-opaque material that shows up strongly in radiographic images. It's typically used to highlight soft tissue structures that normally do not stand out in radiographic images. For example, iodine can be introduced into the circulatory system to highlight vascular structures. In this case, we see a fluoroscopic image following injection of an iodine-based contrast medium into the abdominal aorta. In this case, it demonstrates a complete obstruction of the patient's right common iliac artery. The procedure typically involves feeding a catheter through a vascular channel to the point of interest in order to inject the contrast media. In this case, the left coronary artery is being visualized. The view lasts for only a fraction of a second, as blood flow quickly clears away the medium. A video is recorded, however, and still frames can be analyzed for clinical issues. In this case, a blockage within the main arterial branch can be identified. For visualization of the gastrointestinal tract, a barium-based contrast media is typically introduced. This can be through an oral ingestion for an upper GI series to assess the esophagus and stomach, through an intestinal tube for a small bowel series, and for a large bowel series, the barium enema. In the case of double contrast studies, air is later introduced to provide further resolution of the tissues. In recent years, plain film radiographs have been generally replaced with digital radiography. The concept is similar to that for digital photography, in which the film is replaced with a photosensitive plate that converts radiation intensity into a digital signal that can then be constructed into a two-dimensional image. Not surprisingly, the initial setup cost is higher, as the equipment is more expensive than what is seen with traditional radiography. Operational costs are lower, however, as there is no cost associated with photosensitive film and film development. At the moment, the equipment is bulky, which makes it less versatile as far as portability is concerned. This is likely to change over time as the technology improves. A huge advantage of this approach is the storage of the digitized images in what is commonly referred to as a picture archive computer system, or PACS for short. Even older systems involving film utilize automated scanning systems to give digitized images. As with all other digital media, the findings can be shared through secure online databases with all members of the patient's healthcare team. Previously, you would have had to request physical films from the patient's clinical file, which could take several days to be delivered. As already mentioned, radiographs evolved as improved forms of imaging over the original photos of phosphorescent screens. That being said, fluoroscopy is still used under certain conditions to capture images and video in real time. It's similar in design to the original equipment that captured some of the videos we saw earlier, but the resolution has improved and a pulse beam is used in place of a continuous stream of X-ray radiation to minimize X-ray exposure. The procedure is still valuable in evaluating anatomical movements and the movement of contrast media, which helps with certain diagnoses. For example, the fluoroscopic images on the right were used in the identification of what is known as a Zanker's diverticulum, which is an outpouching of the pharynx that can entrap food and lead to medical complications. The next topic to discuss is computed axial tomography, or CAT scan for short. The technology builds upon plain film radiographs by encasing the X-ray source and detector opposite one another in a rotating collar. As the collar rotates, with the patient positioned within the center of the ring, a series of radiographs are taken at different positions, providing radiographic images at multiple angles. The data is sent to a computer which calculates beam intensity at the various angles and uses complex calculations to determine a pixel intensity for each designated point within the ring. This is used to generate a cross-sectional image that represents culmination of this combined data. These images, called transaxial scans, can be thought of as looking at a slice of bread within a loaf. Again, there is a standardized view for these transaxial images, in which the slice is oriented to the viewer as an inferior angle. In other words, the image is oriented as if the viewer is standing at the patient's feet, looking towards their head. This means that the right side of the patient's body appears on the left side of the screen, and the left side of the body on the right side of the screen. It's beneficial to get used to this approach to allow practitioners to quickly orient themselves, recognizing structures such as the right kidney and liver with only a quick glance at the screen. CT images are generated using the same radiation as used in plain film radiographs, so the imaging densities, or shades of gray, are more or less the same. The biggest difference between the two approaches is that while the images generated in plain film radiographs show the entire three-dimensional anatomy compressed into two-dimensional space, CT images demonstrate a true two-dimensional slice through the body. Using the bread analogy, while a radiograph attempts to demonstrate the entire loaf in a single semi-transparent picture, the CT image focuses on a single slice within that loaf. This allows for greater resolution of structures of interest without superfluous anatomy getting in the way. The disadvantage is that anatomical structures, healthy or diseased, exist in three-dimensional space, and a single CT slice typically gives an incomplete picture of the disease state. To address this problem, segmental images of the region of interest are typically taken. This is accomplished by advancing the image bed through the CT ring as it revolves. This results in a spiraling CT pattern, producing multiple slices at regular intervals through the body. This allows physicians to scroll back and forth through the slices in order to get a more complete picture of the three-dimensional anatomy and tissue pathology. In addition, computer programs exist which can take the spiral data and reconstruct it into three-dimensional models. This would be like taking individual slices of bread and stacking them together to recreate the original loaf. The software can manipulate the various intensities of the data points, expressed as Hounsfield units, to highlight certain anatomical structures over others. In the example on the right, the data was manipulated to eliminate anterior structures, as well as intensities related to fats and fluids surrounding posterior organs, to give us a view of the abdominal aorta. The image highlights the case of an abdominal aortic aneurysm. Similar types of images as those obtained from CT scans can be collected using a completely different type of technology. Magnetic resonance imaging, or MRI for short, takes advantage of spin properties related to protons within hydrogen atoms. You're probably already familiar with the concept of an electron orbiting around a nucleus from basic chemistry. What you might be less aware of is the concept that that lone proton making up the hydrogen nucleus spins on an axis within the nucleus. The direction of the spin is somewhat arbitrary, with half of these protons spinning one way, as in a clockwise pattern, for example, and the other half spinning the other way, in a counterclockwise direction, which apparently I can't achieve. When a hydrogen nucleus is bombarded with radio waves, it tends to become excited. If this happens in a strong magnetic field, the excited protons will all align and begin spinning in a single direction. As soon as the radio signal is removed, many of the protons will revert back to the opposite spin direction and emit their own radio waves as this happens. Using a series of radio pulses, these hydrogen atoms can be triggered to emit their own intermittent radio pulses that can be picked up by a detector, similar to the way in which X-ray diffraction patterns are detected in a CT scan. With the radio frequency that is used, only the protons found in hydrogen atoms will be triggered to emit radio waves. So different tissues can be distinguished by their hydrogen concentrations, as well as by the types of compounds containing hydrogen, which affects the frequency of the proton emissions. As we saw with CT scans, MRI technology allows for two-dimensional transaxial slices and the ability to scan a target range of the body to pan through sequential scans or generate three-dimensional images of the scanned regions. Because of the different technology used to capture the data, the appearance of the tissue from the raw data differs between the two technologies. As previously stated, radiodense structures such as bone will appear white with X-ray technology, while in MRI scan, fat tissues and serous fluid will have a lighter appearance due to their hydrogen content relative to the bone. To further complicate the matter, there are different means by which radio signals emitted from the hydrogen protons can be detected. It's a little beyond the point of discussion for the present lecture, but it results in different image intensities for a given tissue within a sample. T1 weighted scans put greater emphasis on fat-rich tissues and are considered useful for visualizing general morphological information for the body. T2 weighted scans will also highlight water content to a greater extent and are considered useful in identifying examples of tissue edema and inflammation. Further discussion of when T1 and T2 scans should be used can wait for subsequent clinical rotations, but it's important to become familiar with the terms and the general differences between these two types of scans to prepare you to address questions within the clinical setting. There are a number of advantages in using MRI, including greater resolution and differentiation of soft tissue structures than can be attained with CT scanning, and the lack of radiation exposure that comes with CT scanning. There are, however, some caveats to be aware of. The first is related to the use of high-energy electromagnets in obtaining MRI scans. There have been countless examples of situations in which metal objects have been brought too close to MRI machines. Now, normally there are metal detectors that trigger alarms if an individual attempts to enter a room with an operating MRI machine, but if individuals are distracted or wearing headphones, they may continue without regard, with devastating results. We can even see the example of a service pistol that was carried in by an armed escort for a prison inmate. These are costly mistakes that require the machine to be shut down to correct, but can also lead to significant injury if a person is in the machine at the time. Here we see a technician and orderly pinned to the machine when the orderly walked into the room with an oxygen cylinder. I also know of an incident in which an MRI technician walked into a room to check on a patient, forgetting that he had a metal fork in his pocket from lunch. In this case, the patient was stabbed in the shoulder. These dangers can be more subtle as well. Sheet metal workers are at a risk of injury if small splinters of metal collect around the outside of the eye, which can lead to tissue damage and burns. Shrapnel and bullet fragments are also a concern and contraindications for MRI scans. The final technique to discuss is ultrasound. Again, this is a very different form of medical imaging from radiology or MRI, which uses sonar to acquire images. A newer technique based on variable technology. Let's face it, bats have been using sonar for millennia to navigate their way through dark caves. The technique involves a probe containing piezoelectric quartz crystals that rapidly change shape in response to an electrical current. With an oscillating AC current, the rapid changes create ultrasonic vibrations that can penetrate biological tissues. When the waves encounter a density change, as occurs at the interface between two organs, a portion of the ultrasound wave is reflected back towards the probe, which also contains a transducer to detect the reflected waves. This information is transformed into a real-time image that appears on the screen. Again, as with MRI technology, ultrasound does not involve any harmful radiation exposure. The technology itself is lightweight, transportable, and inexpensive, which makes ultrasound much more versatile. Handheld units exist that communicate with tablets and cell phones and are becoming a regular piece of equipment in family medicine clinics. Similar to fluoroscopy, the ultrasound units collect real-time video of biological movements. Here we see an ultrasound video of my oldest son at 5 months gestation in utero. An additional use of this technology is to determine the general direction of movement of substances within the body by looking at frequency shifts within the reflected sound waves. These can then be shown graphically with colors to represent material traveling towards or away from the probe. In the present example, Doppler ultrasound identifies a major artery and vein, as well as a second vein with no detectable movement due to blockage from a deep vein thrombosis. That's going to do it for our introduction to medical imaging. Hopefully you found it beneficial as you apply these various technologies to interpreting the anatomy that you are studying throughout the term. As for myself, I'll be studying how to do a reverse flip. Better. Until next time, this has been Dr. Stuart Inglis. Enjoy the rest of your day.